Good morning. Welcome to the house of the Lord. The light of the Lord is surely shining on this place. Praise God. Won't you join me to the call of worship? The voice of God calls us. Are you listening? The hands of God beckon us. Are you paying attention? The love of God asks us, are you ready to follow? Come, let us worship God, whose tenacious love never stops calling and beckoning us, asking him us to follow.
Thank you, Lord.
Praise God. Won't you stand and join me in singing in Songs of Zion, O Freedom?
Oh, God. Praise God this morning. It is so good to be together in the house of the Lord. Amen. And we come this morning celebrating Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King his weekend. A lot of work still to be done to realize the dream. Amen. Amen. We want to just recognize our long lost, but not sister, lost sister, Kathleen Good. Amen. Yay! Amen. Amen. Kathleen has told us that she was going to get here, took the train down from her home up there in Grass Valley to be here, had a friend that she stayed with, and so we're just thankful to see her in person. It's been a long while. You know, it's good to see on Zoom, but it's always better to see folk in person. Amen. Amen. You can't give hugs across Zoom. We can see smiles and we can see faces. Sometimes we can see faces if we adjust our cameras right. But we can't give hugs across Zoom. We can only give the hugs in person. And so it's good to be together in worship this morning. Worship all of our visitors and guests this morning, those that are attending worship for the first time in 2024 in the sanctuary or online, welcome this morning. Praise be to God. Praise be to God. This morning, as we come together in a time of prayer, do want to lift up Brother Ed Green, who we understand is going to be going home on Tuesday. And so we pray for Brother Ed and for caregivers. We continue to be in prayer for our sister Felicia Phillips. We know that there are some that have had COVID and the flus that haven't allowed them to be at church. And so we continue to pray for their healing and for those that are still traveling, that God would provide travel mercies. I want to lift up our sister Eva Richardson. Her husband Huey is going through some challenging times and Eva doesn't want to leave him alone on Sundays. Her sons aren't able to be with him on Sunday to provide care. And so she's staying at home, but I know she's watching online. And so we just pray for Eva and Brother Huey this morning. Amen. Amen. We pray for all standing in the need of prayer. Our prayers are effective. Whether a person knows that we're praying for them or not, our prayers are indeed effective. Because God hears each and every one of our prayers. Praise God. Praise God. And so as we pray this morning, I want to offer a special prayer of confession and listening. And then I'll invite you to come to the prayer rail. So let us join our hearts together as we pray this confession. When we confess our sins, we accept God's invitation to clear out the noise and chaos that keeps us from recognizing God's loving voice. So as we come to confess our sin and be reconciled to God and one another, take this opportunity to let God help you declutter your heart and your mind so that you might listen and receive God's love and guidance more clearly. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you as our God, nor have we loved our neighbors as ourselves. Our priorities do not line up with yours, and too often we wander from your path by trying to do things our way instead of yours. Forgive us, Lord. Your servants repent. Merciful God, we confess that we too are often complacent in answering your call to enact justice. You call us to enter the flow of your justice that rolls down like water, and instead we inhibit the work of justice by choosing not to pay attention or believe the stories of suffering and need in our midst. Forgive us, Lord. Your servants repent. Merciful God, we confess that sometimes we avoid you. We don't want to hear your voice. We don't want to receive your call. We are scared of what you might ask us to do and how letting your grace work in our lives might change us. So we keep you at arm's length, ready to run when you seem to ask too much of us. Forgive us, Lord. Your servants repent. Merciful God, we confess that there are things that clutter our hearts and minds that we cannot say aloud or do not have words for. And so we lift them to you. Reconciling God, your steadfast love surrounds us, calling us into right relationship with you, with self, with one another, and with creation. As your reconciled and forgiven people, open our hearts to receive all that you have to say to us this day. Speak, Lord, your servants are listening. Loving God, you call us by name to be your people in the world, pouring your love into us in such abundance that it overflows into the world around us. Guide us, form us, and send us as your people to live out your good news wherever we go. Call us, Lord. Your servants will follow. I invite you to come to the throne of grace, the throne of mercy, to stand or kneel before God, to lift up your prayers of confession, those words that you may not be able to say aloud or that you don't have words for, to come before the throne of grace and mercy just to say, good morning. Thank you, God. Let God's people come. Share your hearts as you pray for others. Don't forget to pray for yourselves. Thank you. given us to care for our brothers and our sisters. Lord God, help us in this Martin Luther King weekend not just to think about an extra day off, not just to remember the dream, but to be in conversation about what we need to be about to realize the dream. So much injustice, hurt, pain in the world. So many wars going on. This was not the vision of the dream. So help us to be peacemakers. Help us to work for justice. Help us to bring your kingdom of heaven here on earth. Oh Lord God, the task might seem overwhelming, but your words of scriptures tell us don't be afraid. For nothing is impossible with God, that we can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. So help us to trust your word. Help us to trust your presence. Help us to remember that you are Emmanuel, God with us. And we'll be careful to give you the glory, the honor, and the praise. We pray all of this in the name of the newborn King, Jesus the Christ, who taught his disciples and teaches us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day. Not yet? Okay, we'll wait till he gets here. I want to lift up a celebration. The East Bay Municipal Utilities District, also known as East Bay Mud, that's how you make your checks out, their board of directors has elected Lisa R. McIntosh as president. Praise God. Our very own sister, Lisa McIntosh, we celebrate you and say congratulations. She is the first African-American woman elected to serve as vice president and president of the board. She will lead the board as East Bay Mud begins its second century of service. And she is confident that the board's dedication to public service and innovation will help East Bay Mud tackle the pressing issues facing water, water waste, utilities nationwide. She is a champion of climate justice, environmentalism. And so we have much to learn. She and I are in conversation about her giving a workshop, not just to Easter Hill, but to this neighborhood, about how the water work system, how it works, how we can conserve water, how we can maybe change our landscaping so that it's water neutral, and debunk some of the myths. And so please pray for her as she takes on these new duties and we find time to come together to do a presentation for the community. It was a presentation we wanted to do last year, but because of her health challenges, wasn't able to do it. So we continue to pray for Sister Lisa's health and for her role in the East Bay Utility District, the leadership that she will bring. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. We also received a note from our principal, Helen Burke, down the street at Martin Luther King Elementary School. Praise God, praise God. Keep everybody safe. Dr. MLK Elementary will be celebrating Dr. King's life and legacy this coming Friday at 9 a.m. in their multipurpose room. And she's inviting any that want to attend to be there from 9 to 9:45. And one of the things they're going to do in the celebration is lift up Dr. King's visit here at Easter Hill. And so if you were here when Dr. King was here, please let me know. You may, so that I might let her know that you'd be willing to come and share a moment, share a memory. Amen. We want to educate the kids on their history. Sometimes we forget so much of our history, and it needs to be made known. Amen. So we pray for that celebration to take place at MLK Elementary this coming Friday, the 19th at 9 a.m. I was late getting out the e-news this week. Went out this morning, so there's some articles in there about MLK celebrations this afternoon from 4 to 6, as well as tomorrow. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, sister.
It's offering time!
Praise the Lord.
And there's a special offering for, Human Relations Sunday. I talk so loud, I don't think I really need this. Okay. Won't you be in prayer with me? God of all wisdom, how often we have been deaf to your voice speaking to our hearts, especially when we move in the world that needs it so desperately. The readings from 1 Samuel bring us to the phrase, "The word of the Lord was rare in those days," which resonates with the relevance of the evening news. As we bring our gifts to be dedicated to this morning, we pray that you might open our ears, our hearts, and to hear where you're calling us to respond with obedience, so that we might do what you need to begin healing our world. In Jesus Christ we pray, amen.
Amen.
We who believe in love.
without you, I would have lost it all. But now I see how you were there for me, and I can say, never would have made it. Never could have made it without you. I would have lost it all. But now I see how you were there for me, and I can say, I'm stronger, I'm wiser, I'm better, much better. When I look back over all you brought me through, I can see that you were the one I held on to, and I never, never.
Somebody just need to testify to somebody next to them. Tell them, I'm strong. I'm wise. Is there anybody in this house other than me that could declare you made it? Tell your neighbor, never would have made it. Tell them, never could have made it.
Never could have made it.
My God, my God. Good morning, everybody. Good morning. We're going to have a quick children's moment on Dr. King, and I have two volunteers that didn't know they were going to volunteer till they got here. But I do want to reiterate, I think that's the word, the bulletin announcement about the children. We're starting in person again, the last Saturday in every month. And as soon as I set that date, can't make it, because Jasmine's getting an award that day, but the next day, Sunday, it should say February 28th is in your bulletin. Bring your kids, or they should already be here for church, and just leave them till 1 o'clock, from 12 to 1 on the last Sunday, and we're going to be giving out parts for the Black History presentation that we'll do. And you guys know that stuff comes to me middle of the night, so we're going to do what we can do, how we can do it. But bring, how many of you have school-age children, grandkids, school-age nieces, nephews? Get them here, and we're going to do a presentation in person. So today, we're going to hear just a couple of poems about Dr. King, and our first presenter is going to tell you his name and who he is. He didn't know he was going to do it either.
Hello, everyone. My name is Dr. Anema Orokari, and today I'm going to be giving you, I'm going to be reciting a poem titled Martin Luther King Jr. They tried to kill the dream when they shot down Dr. King, but the dream he preached remains alive in spite of everything. The dream of equal justice, of freedom, liberty, the dream that all the world can live as one community. In spite of all the hatred, suspicion, rage, and strife, the dream is there for all to seek, to find a better life. Though Martin Luther King is dead, the dream he preached lives still in hearts of all good people, and there it always will. By Martin Luther King Jr. by Susan Altman and Susan Lechner.
Thank you. And then I have a couple of misconceptions. As I heard pastors say, we have to educate our children. They have no idea who Dr. King was or when he was. Because our young kids passed last year, 2-3 years ago, it's difficult for them. So one, Dr. Martin Luther King was not president. He was not the first black president. He wasn't president. He was never the president. Number two, he did not free the slaves. This is what the kids think. Dr. King did not free, and I've been told to not say slaves, but enslaved. They didn't choose to be that way. Number three, Dr. King hated white people. Absolutely not. He loved everybody, and he wants us to all love everybody. And Dr. King fought for just black people. No. The things that he did and those around him changed the world for everybody. For everybody. So we're going to end with a poem. Come on up here, Drew. He had no idea. His mama doesn't know he's up here. And he's going to help us with this poem. And the title is?
MLK.
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 He knew that love was a better way.
MLK.
Say it again.
MLK.
He marched the streets in a peaceful way.
MLK.
Say it again.
MLK.
Thousands came to listen to the words he had to say.
MLK.
One more time.
MLK.
He showed the world how to keep injustice away.
MLK. MLK.
He left the world too soon, but his teaching will always stay.
MLK. MLK.
Martin Luther King Jr., we will always be thankful for the path you showed us to a better way.
One time. MLK.
Thank you.
All right.
done.
Did he say? Who this? Harpo, who this? Sorry.
Praise God. Y'all keep your eye on Drew. He's growing up right before our eyes.
Yep.
Amen. Serving as an usher, helping with the children's Thank moment. God. Keep your eye on Drew. Keep loving on him and keep encouraging him. Amen. We thank Jasmine this morning. I don't know if she's still here, but we thank Jasmine for her praise dance this morning. There she come running from the fellowship hall. There was a lot of folks standing up in the back watching such power and energy. Continue to let the Lord use you. Amen. Amen. Wanted to offer this during prayer time, but wasn't here yet. But we got this little man standing before us, Brother Alexander. Good morning, Alexander. Yeah. All right. Alexander celebrated his first birthday on January 8th. His second birthday on January 8th. And so we just... thankful that he's in our midst. We remember his twin brother that passed, Jackson. And so we continue to pray for Brother Akbar, his dad, and Jacqueline, his mom. And we just continue to watch him grow up in front of us. Remember when he wasn't even crawling. And then he was crawling, and now he wants to run all over the sanctuary. The precious child of God, we give God thanks for your birthday, Alexander. Amen.
Won't you hear the word of God for the people of God? Now the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord under Eli. The word of the Lord was rare in those days. Remember that. The word of the Lord were rare in those days, and visions were not widespread. At that time, Eli, whose head eyesight had begun to grow dim so that he could not see, was laying in his room. The lamp of the Lord had not yet gone out, and Samuel was laying in the temple of the Lord, where the ark of the God was. Then the Lord called, "Samuel, Samuel." And he said, "Here I am." And he ran to Eli, and he said, "Here I am. You called me?" But he said, "I didn't call you. Lay down again." And he went and laid down, and the Lord called him again, "Samuel." Samuel got up and went to see Eli. And he said, "Here I am. You called me?" But he said, "I did not call you, son. Lay down again." Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord and the word of the Lord, and yet it had not yet been revealed to him. The Lord said to Samuel again a third time, and he got up and he went to Eli and said, "Here I am, you called me." Then Eli perceived the Lord was calling the boy. Therefore Eli said to Samuel, "Go and lie down. And if he calls you again, you shall say, 'Speak, Lord, your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went and he laid down in his place. Now the Lord came and stood there and calling him as before, "Samuel, Samuel." And Samuel said, "Speak to me, your servant is listening."
Miriam hid a baby in the bush in the bulrushes, disobeying the Pharaoh's edict to kill the male children of the Hebrew slaves. The children grew to adulthood, called by God. He liberated his people from Pharaoh's bondage. And Miriam sang a freedom song.
Jonah, called by God to preach repentance to his enemies in Nineveh, resisted. He fled Nineveh in a storm-tossed ship. Rescued from the depths of the sea, he returned to the enemy city, preached and witnessed the Ninevites' salvation when they turned to God.
Mary, the mother of Jesus, accepted her call from God with rejoicing, saying, God has filled the hungry with good food and set the rich away empty.
Paul, the apostle, journeyed over the known world, founding Christian communities. Called by God, he preached reconciliation to Jew and Gentile, creating controversy among his colleagues as he pursued God's purpose of peace among estranged people.
Women marched together, carrying banners and demanding peace and justice. They sought peace among men and women and peace based on justice between races. Called by God, they struggled 70 years to win the right to vote in the United States so their granddaughters could take up the work they had begun.
Black and white marched together in Alabama, Mississippi, Chicago, and Washington, D.C., called by God to turn the nation around. Martin Luther King was our drum major, keeping rhythm as we walked toward a new day when liberty and justice would be shared in peace by all.
The march continues as we raise our voices with all who are oppressed, violated, and rendered invisible because the gender identity, sexual orientation, race, age, ability, and economic status, we are called to join with all creation, crying out a just peace.
Christ, our peace, we hear your call. We experience your ministry through the lives of peacemakers and justice seekers. Guide us as we follow the path of shalom. We thank you for the cloud of witnesses who have known your presence in their struggles. Every step of the way to peace, your promise is sure that peace is possible when we follow in the way you lead. Amen.
Amen.
Good morning. I'm Barbara Guillory, and I'll be reading John 1, verses 43 through 51, New Revised Standard Version, Updated Edition. Jesus calls Philip and Nathanael. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him, about whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus, son of Joseph from Nazareth." Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." When Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him, he said of him, "Here is truly an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." Nathanael asked him, "Where did you get to know me?" Jesus answered, "I saw you under the fig tree before Philip called you." Nathanael replied, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus answered, "Do you believe because I told you I saw you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Very truly I tell you, you will see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." Amen. Amen.
Our sermon not this hymn this morning celebrates the favorite song as well as the most requested song by Dr. King. This song is none other than Precious Lord, Take My Hand. An interpretation by our own sister, Joanne Lawson. God bless you as you sing. Amen.
Take my hand,
Oh Lord, take my hand, precious Lord, and lead your child on home.
We done had church this morning. Nothing but the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost has been present in this sanctuary this morning. When we open ourselves to the Holy Spirit will use us in mighty ways. Thank you, Joanne. Thank you to each of the readers this morning, to the dancers, to the storytellers, to our musicians. Amen. God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
Oh.
I was watching the hands that were up. In those hands, I think we're praising God.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen?
But I want you to remember too, when you're not praising God and you're down there at the pit or you're by the river feeling like you're about to drown, raise your hand up.
Yeah.
Raise your hand up and just say, precious Lord, take my hand. Don't make God work so hard that he got to reach all the way down to your side. Put your hand up. Let's give God a hand praise. Amen. Amen. This morning, I want to spend a few minutes talking about listening and following God. Martin Luther King couldn't have done what he did had he not listened and followed God. Had he not surrendered to his own will and way, but followed the will and way of the Christ. This week's reading from 1 Samuel recounts God's call to Samuel. Samuel comes on the scene at a crucial moment in Israel's history. The loose social order that existed among the tribes of Israel for several generations after being settled in the land following the exodus from Egypt had begun to unravel through weak political leadership in the face of the Palestinian threat and corrupt religious practices. Man, I wanted to change that so much. Through the weak and misguided political leadership of our nation and the corrupt practices of Christian nationalism. Samuel's mother, Hannah, had dedicated him at birth to the Lord at the shrine at Shiloh, where we meet him some years later in this passage, serving under Eli the priest. People were not listening to God in those days, and God did not speak. Let me say that again. People were not listening to God in those days. And so God didn't waste his breath. He didn't speak. Word from the Lord was rare in those days. Frequent visions were infrequent. This is the context for God's calling to the prophet Samuel. Nathanael is convinced to follow Jesus because Jesus saw him sitting under a fig tree. Let us pray. gracious, and almighty God, your word matters. Through your word you spoke and creation came into being. Jesus Christ came incarnate in the flesh and is the Word. Lord God, you sent the prophets to speak to us. May we listen to your Word. And may we follow your Word. For your Word is truth and light and life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Is there anyone in your life who helps you to discern when God is calling or speaking to you? This morning I've been looking at a particular section in the sanctuary. Three brothers, Reverend Stan Bias, Brother Lavelle Brown, and Brother Vernon Goins. Them brothers grew up together. They know each other. They trust one another. They know more about each other than I know about any one of them. They're here worshiping and praising the Lord. Praise God for the brothers who worship the Lord. I love this story in the Bible, in 1 Samuel. At times I find it comical. It's like a Laurel and Hardy or a Three Stooges comedy. Samuel keeps getting up, going to Eli, and Eli says, go lay back down. Ain't nobody called you. And it keeps happening. And you have to wonder, what is Samuel hearing? You have to wonder what Samuel is hearing. But the third time when God calls, Eli, the priest, finally recognized that it was the Lord calling Samuel. Had to wonder, why did it take Eli so many times to figure out that it was the Lord calling Samuel? But as much as I find this comical, there are times when I find myself in a story. Is God calling me and I don't recognize God's voice, don't recognize who's calling? Ever been there? In the middle of the night, you get woken up and you wonder why. Why was Samuel unable to recognize the voice of the Lord the first times that the Lord called him? The text tells us in verse 7, now Samuel did not know the Lord. And the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. How could this be? His mother knew the Lord. She dedicated him to temple service. He was raised in the temple working with the priests and the other faithful workers. Had nobody told him about the Lord? Had nobody told him how to listen for the voice of God? Do we have people in our churches today to whom the Lord has not yet been revealed? There are many things going on in the world that keep the word of the Lord from being revealed. Our world is loud with distractions aplenty, many other voices calling, blaming, warning, and vying for our attention. It's loud in our souls when we are filled with our own questions and fears, filled with our own failures and inadequacies. What noises impede you from listening to the voice of God when God speaks to you? This morning, I want to have a short Hebrew lesson. There are stages to spiritual ascension. God's call, kara. God's call, kara. Q-A-R-A in Hebrew. Kara, God's call. Humanity is present and attentive. Hineni. Hineni. H-I-N-N-E-I-N-I. Hineni. Humanity, present and attentive. And then God speaks. Let me make it plain. God calls and is looking for our presence and our availability. God is not looking for our degrees, our economic status, our position. God is looking for hineni. Here I am. He's looking for our response to say, here I am. Not half-heartedly, not here I am while multitasking, but being fully present to God's call. Hineni is a relationship, a relational partnership. Kara, kara, God's calling is different than speaking. God can call, but if we don't answer, God can't speak. It's like the phone ringing, and it's ringing and ringing, but nobody's picking up. Once we pick up the phone, the person on the other end can speak. Here I am. Speak. How could the fullness or lack of hineni, here I am, in your life be impacting your call from God? Fullness. Fullness of God. When I am clearly hearing, I'm led by the Spirit. Amen. I'm productive, moving ministry forward, connecting and touching lives. Lack of fullness. When I'm not clearly hearing, I feel disconnected, lose a sense of call and purpose. I struggle. I get distracted by too many other calls that have nothing to do with ministry, with changing the world. Too much paperwork, too much shuffling of papers, too much time on social media, maybe too much time watching TV. What about you? What is it like when you are living in the fullness of God? How does it feel? What is going on when you are clearly hearing God? How does hineni, here I am, in your life intersect with your relationships, with your family, your friends, your current communities, and people beyond your current community? I've been in some different venues the last couple of weeks. I think I shared with you, I was at a ceasefire banner raising. And faith communities of all different traditions coming together to say, lift our voices to say, no more war. No more war, cease fire. Cease fire in the Middle East. Cease fire. Permanent ceasefire, not a temporary ceasefire, but a permanent ceasefire. Yeah. Talking about raising banners on our churches, we're going to be talking about that at our January 25th church council about raising a banner. In the gathering, will we remember and celebrate it? Remembered the lives lost just in the city of Oakland through gun violence. 126 murders. All that potential taken away from our communities to make our world a better place. There was a part of me that didn't want to go to those celebrations, those events on New Year's Eve. But Kara, God's call. And I said, Hinani, here I am. And I followed where God sent. And my spirit was touched. How do we stop this gun violence? How do we stop wars around the world? Praying is good, but praying, asking God, what more can we do? What more can we do? When we, as a little old church called Easter Hill, partner with all these other congregations and faith traditions, what a major impact we can have in the world. So don't just say, we a little church, we can't do nothing. When we say that, we're saying, God, you can't do anything. But I believe all things are possible with God. Do we trust? Do we trust or do we run from the call? Are we willing to stand up and take the risk? This week, one of the highlights for me was being on the campus of Contra Costa College. It was my fourth time, and I've been meeting different people at the college. And I've been talking to them about some of our needs here at Easter Hill and how young people, young students, might be able to assist us in some of our ministries, but how we can assist them to learn about the history of Richmond and Black history, how we might be a parent or a grandparent to some of those students that don't have grandparents who have, like my boys, don't know my parents. My parents were gone long before they were born. How they might be encouraged by our witness. Oh, when I saw the reaction of the people that I was meeting with, they said, your presence is an answer to prayer. I said, y'all let me be here as an answer to our prayers. New relationships developing on the horizon. New possibilities. Be in prayer for not just the students at Contra Costa College, but students in high school that are planning their futures and the students that are attending colleges and universities now. Gotta pray for them. Gotta pray for them. Gotta pray for them. How are you present for family, friends, and church members? How are you trying to listen more, to help, to affirm, and to support? How could you spend more time in prayer? 2024, we're almost halfway through the month. I don't know what your New Year's resolutions are, but I'm hoping one of them might have been, I'm gonna spend more time in prayer. Got quiet. It got real quiet. I'm gonna spend more time in prayer. Let me translate that. Yes. I'm going to spend more time talking and listening to God. Yes. I'm going to spend more time listening to God. Sometimes we spend a lot more time talking. And sometimes that talking is telling God what to do or how God should be doing. Instead of listening for God's will and way in our lives. Let's look at the text briefly from the Gospel of John. What kept Nathanael from believing Philip when he told him that Jesus from Nazareth was the Son of God? Again, it's about listening. Nathanael was not listening. His biases and prejudice hindered him from listening clearly. What biases and prejudice might keep us from listening? Oh, we got them. We all got them. We can run around saying, I ain't prejudiced. Well, we all got some prejudices. And we all have some biases. I see some heads shaking. We got to tell the truth. This ain't about somebody else. This is about each and every one of us. Do our biases and prejudice impede us from recognizing God's voice proclaimed through other humans? What might you do this week to listen to God? Sit still. Some of y'all probably got some nice backyard. Do you ever sit out there and just sit and listen? Go sit in a park. Go drive out by the bay. Sit and listen to God. Maybe it's having some instrumental music and hear what words God puts to the music. I don't know how God is calling you to listen, but I know God is calling us to listen. God calls us when we are young, when we are middle-aged, even when the sun is setting in our lives. If we pay attention and open our eyes, we will truly see God's wondrous works in our lives. Whether we are lying down or growing in our mother's womb, God searches us and knows us, comes to us and works in us. God is with us and within us. What does it take to recognize God's voice and receive God's message? We need to listen attentively to the Lord. Samuel answered, "Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening." We need to set everything aside, block out all distractions, be in a comfortable position, and wait. Wait. Those that wait on the Lord. Those that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. We gotta wait patiently, expectantly, with new eyes for seeing, new ears for hearing, and with hope-filled open hearts for receiving. In John, we can't follow Jesus until we know who he is. And who he is for us will depend on who we're looking for. A teacher, a savior, the fulfillment of scripture, the Son of God, the King of Israel. Jesus is all of those things and more. They are merely starting points for our understanding the deeper mysteries of God in our lives, where heaven and earth meet. May we listen to God's call in every moment in our lives as we walk one day at a time on the pilgrimage. Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. Let us pray. God, our guide and comforter, help us recognize your voice amid the many noises that distract us. Please give us the wisdom to listen attentively to your voice and to respond and follow your call. Amen. Sisters and brothers, it is imperative that we listen and we follow our new mission statement. Our new mission statement for the California-Nevada annual conference is following Jesus, thriving in community, and healing the world. Jesus wants us to be agents of his healing and justice. So may we follow Jesus, the teachings of Jesus, and where Jesus would go. May we listen as Dr. King listened. Dr. King listened, and sometimes we don't hear the full, all of his words. King just didn't have a dream about seeing each other through the content of our character. But he has some prophetic words that caused a lot of trouble. He was calling us to deal with racism and poverty and militarism, imperialism, the three giant triplets. They didn't go away, folk. You know that. They didn't go away, they're still here. And we gotta rise up to fight those that are taking away our rights and our freedoms. Don't want to have little Alexander and Drew start to fight all over again. We got to fight so they have a better world. We got to fight. We got to maintain our voting rights, securing the voting rights for every person, and stop letting them remove those key provisions, taking away polling places, requiring more voter IDs. We gotta stop this nonsense. We gotta stop this nonsense. Yes. Folks are gonna be asking for poll workers. Folks are gonna be asking for folks to be at the polls, watching to make sure things go right. And they'll be training for folks that say, here I am, hineni, here I am, use me. 2024 is going to be a crucial year. It can be a make or break year. Let's get ready for the fight. Let's get ready for the fight. Let's get ready. Because God is calling us. Amen. We got a few announcements in the bulletin. If I can find my bulletin. Here it is. Want to lift up the thank you from Mission and Outreach. Thank you. Thank you for your assistance in the Angel Tree, helping all of our children to have a good Christmas. Amen. Thank you for the poinsettias that decorated our sanctuary. Want to lift up the church training on next Saturday, the 20th. And you'll see it in the e-news that was sent out this morning. It's for lay leaders and trustees and treasurers and church council chair and SPRC members, nomination, finance. You may say, I'm not serving on any of those committees. You can still register to attend. Maybe you have an interest in one of those committees, but you don't know what they do. Sign up so that you can learn what those committees do. Maybe you need a refresher. You haven't attended one of these workshops for a while. Sign up. One of the things I love about Easter Hill, we represent. We show up. And so thank you to all those that have already registered. Amen? Amen. Oh, let us sing our closing song. Let us sing our closing song this morning. We shall overcome. We shall overcome.
one of our ebony bishops who's gone on to glory, Bishop Roy Nichols, used to sing, "Not Someday, But Today." If we work hard, we can make it today. Not sometime in the distant future, but we can make it happen today. I invite you to join us in the fellowship hall for refreshments. The worship committee will be meeting in the beauty room at 12 o'clock. And there's going to be a save the date notice coming out. Reverend Carolyn Anderson is bringing vision to our music department, and we're planning on a Black History concert on the fourth Sunday of February, February 25th. And I'm going to tell you how big the vision is. The sanctuary is too small. So El Sobrante United Methodist Church, that has plenty of parking and a large sanctuary, has agreed to be the host church for the concert. So get the word out. Easter Hill Choir and Guest, Black History Month concert, Sunday afternoon, 4 p.m., February 25th. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Receive this benediction. Beloved disciples, go from this place ready to listen for God's voice and to follow the Spirit's lead as we answer the call to build God's beloved community for justice, peace, and flourishing for all in our homes, our neighborhoods, and in our world. Amen,
amen.
And amen. Good to see you.
I don't know if you remember me.
Chris.
Yes. I was at the table.
Good to see you.